In this video, we'll compare C# with .NET Framework to Golang. In the first test, we'll focus on bare minimum frameworks themselves. We'll measure CPU usage, memory usage, the number of clients each application can handle per second, and most importantly, end user latency. We'll run the first test until one of the applications fails, and then continue a bit longer to find the breaking point for the second application. In the second test, we'll replicate a common use case where we read a file from the local file system. In this case, it's an image that we'll upload to S3 bucket. We'll also save some metadata about that image in relational database, such as Postgres. Additionally, we'll measure S3 latency and the database query latency for inserting the data. Based on the previous benchmarks and feedback, I'll also measure the number of connections each application creates to the database. We'll also measure how long it takes to start the application in the cloud environment. This means not only measuring the boot time, but also how long it takes to pull the image and pass a health check. This will directly affect autoscaling capabilities in the cloud. For the C# comparison, we'll use the latest .NET 8 framework, which is built and open sourced by Microsoft. It's a cross-platform framework that allows you to build different types of applications, from simple web apps and mobile applications to microservices and machine learning models. In this video, we'll use .NET Core framework along with minimal API to build the fastest possible application for this language and framework. According to Microsoft, this setup is supposed to be more performant than Golang. However, their comparison used Jin as the framework for the Go platform. On the other hand, we'll use Golang with a Fiber framework, which is one of the fastest HTTP frameworks for the language. However, some people don't like Fiber because it's not fully compatible with the standard library, and as a result, not all middleware, observability tools, and other related components work with Fiber right out of the box. Now, let's go over the tests themselves. I have a home lab where I use VMware Hypervisor to create a multi-node Kubernetes cluster. I already have some monitoring components set up in Kubernetes. There is Prometheus server to scrape metrics, Grafana to visualize those metrics and create dashboards, and CIAdvisor to scrape every single Kubernetes node and provide basic CPU, memory, and network usage metrics for each pod. I also have KubeState metrics, which we'll use to measure startup time. First, we deploy our applications to Kubernetes cluster. I have a client that can be configured to generate load and measure the latency of each request. The best way to measure latency is from external client, as this gives you the same experience any end user of your application would experience. When the client starts sending requests, Prometheus scrapes those metrics and we use them in the dashboard. For the second test, we'll use another endpoint /API/images on our application. Every time client sends a request, our application will read a file from the local file system and upload it to S3 bucket. Instead of using AWS S3, I'll use Minio, S3 compatible object store, which I'll also deploy to Kubernetes. After the client uploads the image, we'll write some metadata about the image, such as timestamp when it was created, the file name, and other details to a relational database, in this case Postgres, which I'll also deploy to Kubernetes. You can find the source code for each application, as well as Terraform, Helm charts, and YAML files for the monitoring components in my public GitHub repository. In this test, we'll also instrument each application with Prometheus client to measure specific function calls. For example, we'll track how long it takes to upload the image and how long it takes to write to the database. So for the second test, we'll collect metrics from both external client as well as application themselves. Let's compare image sizes for both applications. For the .NET application, we'll use a multi-stage Docker build and distroless image for the final stage. This approach reduces the size of the final image. You could use Alpine for the final stage, but that would increase the size by 1 or 2 megabytes. For the Go application, we'll also use multi-stage build and a distroless image for the final stage. This image is built and provided by Google. Now, let's check the final image sizes. The Go image is more than twice as small as the .NET image. You can even reduce the Go image size more to around 39 megabytes. A smaller image means Kubernetes will need less time to pull the image and start application. Next, let's measure startup time. This includes not only how long it takes for the application to start, but also how long it takes for Kubernetes to pull the image and for the pod to pass a health check. This isn't a very scientific approach, since network speed would greatly affect the time it takes to pull the image, but you still get a general idea. We can use kubestate metrics to measure the time it takes for the pod to become ready. You can find the dashboard in my repo as well. Alright, let's create two pods and see how long it takes. Golang starts first because the image size is smaller, while C# comes second. I ran this test multiple times and also deleted the image from Kubernetes node each time. If you use Carpenter, Autoscaler, or just spot nodes in the cloud, you should consider that Kubernetes will need to pull the image each time. Otherwise, the boot time is similar. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. First, I'll deploy these applications to Kubernetes and let them run for about 20 minutes without any load. You may notice that C# has slightly higher CPU usage, but the real difference is in memory usage. In idle state, C# and .NET framework consumes significantly more memory compared to Golang. Now, let's start the test. First, we'll run 10 clients for about 5 minutes, resulting in around 20 requests per second to each application. You'll immediately notice a spike in CPU usage for the C#, and the overall latency measured from the client side is significantly higher, but memory usage shows little effect since we're just returning hard-coded devices in JSON payload. Next, let's jump to 50 clients, which will produce around 100 requests per second. The difference in CPU usage increases, and the difference in latency remains consistent. Now, we'll increase the number of clients to 200. Overall latency decreases, but the relative ratio stays about the same. At this point, Golang is more efficient using less CPU. Let's keep going and increase the number of clients to 400 for the next 5 minutes. Then we'll drop the number of clients to 5 for 5 minutes to see how applications adapt. Next, we'll try 10 clients. From here on, we'll start with 550 clients and keep increasing every 5 minutes until one application fails. At around 1200 requests per second, you'll see that .NET application begin to drop some requests. At around 1300 requests per second, .NET application starts failing and you'll notice a spike in latency. We'll continue running it for a couple of more minutes. Finally, we reach a point where Golang starts to drop some requests, but its latency remains within a few milliseconds. The full duration of the test was about 2.5 hours. Now, let me open each graph for the entire duration of the test. First, we have CPU usage. Next is the memory usage graph. Then the number of requests per second. And finally, the overall latency. That's all for the first test, where we compared the frameworks themselves, .NET Minimal API versus Golang Fiber framework, both running side by side in Kubernetes. Now, let's run the second test, and we'll start with 10 clients. You can immediately see the CPU and memory usage are slightly higher. Additionally, we'll measure the latency to see how long it takes to read the file and upload it to S3. So far, Golang application is more efficient under low load. We'll also measure the latency for saving metadata about the file to the relational database. At this point, it looks like Golang performs better and uses significantly less CPU and memory to accomplish this task. Next, let's simulate a spike by temporarily increasing the number of clients to 50 for the next 5 minutes. The S3 latency remains pretty much the same, but the difference in database latency increases. Alright, let's drop back to 10 clients. So, for the next hour or so, I'll gradually increase the number of clients from 100 to 200 to see which app performs better. You can see that .NET increases the pool size, while Golang stays relatively stable. I could have set the pool size manually, but my goal is to test these frameworks and libraries as they are, with all the defaults, which many people would use. Now, let me open CPU usage graph for the entire test duration. Next, we have memory usage. Then, database latency graph. Here's connection pool size for each application. By the way, Postgres by default can open 100 concurrent connections. At least that's the default for the Helm chart I used to deploy the database to Kubernetes. Now, we have client latency. For the requests per second, you can see that Golang can actually process more requests than .NET. And finally, we have S3 latency. Based on the previous video and the feedback I received, I included connection pool size metrics. If you think I should measure anything else in these tests, please let me know and I'll find a way to create that graph. Also, let me know what languages or open source projects I should test next. I also have a playlist with different benchmarks if you're interested. Thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next video.